edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Mike Lenore, here again this week. I hope you had a good week, and hope you stay tuned for our program. Very special guest. Hadn't been back with us in a while, doing so many things. I'm surprised he had time to drop by our program. Dr. James Otis, I'm going to read this. This is just because it's interesting. He's DC, FACFN, FABCDD, DACNB. Fellow of the American College of Functional Neurology, Fellow of the American Board of Childhood Development Disorders, Diplomat of the American Chiropractic Neurology Board. And he's right here in our area. He's a board-certified functional neurologist, practiced for 30 years, offering drug-free treatment for ADHD, learning disabilities, a variety of other neurologic disorders he's developed, and patented brain time, an easy-to-use add-on procedure that I'm sure you'll tell us about that's helpful for a number of different things like ADD and learning disabilities, memory and balance problems, brain injuries and strokes, and he provides continuing education in the field of functional neurology for medical doctors, nurses, all kinds of healthcare providers. Dr. Otis, welcome again to our program.
Well, thank you. I'm so glad to be here.
Tell us exactly about your path, not just professionally into chiropractic, but into these other functional neurology areas. How'd you get there? What did you do? What made you interested?
Well, I was a new chiropractor back in 1981, and my first wife, very shortly after I went into practice, had a head injury, and she couldn't talk. And she would go actually in and out of being able to speak. And we noticed right off the bat that some of the things that we would do would help temporarily. So, for example, we would do a physical therapy procedure and she could talk, but then she lost it. Mm-hmm. Or we'd do a procaine injection into the area of the injury and she could talk, but then she'd lose it. Or I would do some really gentle chiropractic craniosacral work, and she could talk, but then we'd lose it. So that really motivated me. I knew that sensory input to the brain was helping her to a degree, and I knew that we were getting the best care possible. We were going through the medical routes, alternative routes, and I knew that it could go faster and more complete if we had a better system of healing to help her. So that motivated me right from the beginning. And by the way, she recovered and went on to full recovery. But I started studying neurology and how to help. And then over the years, as things typically happen, I started to attract more brain injury patients into my practice. And then started to discover that one person came into me and said, I had really good results with a particular type of sound therapy. So I bought that kind of system to generate that and started using it with clients. And then being who I am, I innovated and changed and improved it and worked with people over a period of 20 years. And first in the brain injury population. And what was really interesting is I discovered things that would help their brain work better, it generalized. So I started getting reports that it was also helping children with ADHD or learning disabilities, or seniors with a memory problem or balance problem, or people with chronic pain.
Now, what was the IT you're talking about?
It was a type of therapy. The IT is what is now brain time, which we'll talk about. It morphed over a period of years. It's a program that people listen to through headphones to precisely timed signals. And the timing of the signals is such that it exercises the brain's ability to speed up and slow down, which is fundamental for every process, the way that your body regulates your physical health, your emotional health, and your mental cognitive health.
So now you've been able through the years to apply. Is this a simple common denominator to most of the things that you're treating, or is it, you know, is going to be unique for certain kinds of things? I noticed that, you know, many chiropractors will not take on the kinds of things that you're talking about, ADHD, learning disabilities, memory and balance, those kinds of things. So what is it that you do differently? I mean, what is it? Let's talk about brain time. That'll give mm-hmm. us some good basis.
Okay.
And what that means.
And we'll talk about brain time and also like my training in my practice as a functional neurologist and a chiropractic neurologist.
Right.
So the field of chiropractic, like the field of medicine, has specialties.
Okay.
And one of ours is neurology and okay. functional neurology. And so that's an extensive study of period of study. I studied for 5 years and flew and took a 3-day exam and got license or credential and that expertise. And so the, what we do is we have very sophisticated ways of looking at how the brain is working outside of neuroimaging. And yes, neuroimaging is helpful, but many of the problems, like we're talking about the ADHD and the learning disabilities and memory problems, they're not a problem with something broken in the brain, a particular part of the brain that's been injured by a stroke or something like that. It is more a problem with how those parts are functioning together or connecting and talking with each other. So there's a field called functional neurology or functional connectivity, how these different parts connect to each other. And that's what we specialize in. So we look at where the parts are working smoothly together and where they're not, and then it's as if we know how to give the brain a tune-up.
Yeah, I mean, I'm still having a little difficulty with the concept. I know I just happened to read a book called Moonwalking with Einstein. It was about a book about memory and how people remember things. And it's good to use something you said, that we do remember. We're visual. I mean, naturally visual, naturally spatial. And if you can integrate that spatial piece into what you're trying to remember, it's easier to remember.
Exactly.
Things. So that when you talk about functional connections, obviously for most of our audience, we don't really know what those connections would look like. Or so let's try to apply it to something like sleep.
Okay. Or even, since you mentioned memory, let's go there and then go to sleep as well.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm walking down the street and I see you across the street, first thing is I recognize your face with the right side of my brain.
Mm-hmm.
And then I remember your name with the left side of my brain.
It must be wrong. Something wrong with my left side because I'm terrible at names.
And then what has to happen is they have to connect. And, you know, how many times have you walked down the street? So I know that person.
Right.
I just know them, but I can't remember their name. And then 5 minutes later, it pops into your mind, oh, that's Judy, right, or, you know, or whatever. And what's happened is when you needed the connection, and we can talk later about, you know, the scientific way of how they connect. But when you needed the connection, it wasn't there. And then a few minutes later, your brain made the connection and you had the complete memory. So every memory has a face, a name, how you knew them, when the last time you saw them. All of those are stored in different parts of the brain, and they have to coalesce to form a memory.
So what I mean, but if they don't, then what can you do? I mean, if they're not coalescing, what can you do to make those pathways work?
Here's a trick. Our brain, every brain cell, whether it's the part that stores the name, the part that stores the face, every brain cell turns on and off many times a second. Literally, it's turning on and off, and technically the membrane potential of that, the voltage potential across the membrane is oscillating. And so when the cell is on, it can talk to its neighbors and it can listen to its neighbors. So it can communicate. Then when it's off, it's deaf and mute. So here are two cells, and they're each turning on and off. If they want to share information, they have to adjust their rhythm so they're both on at the same time and off at the same time. Otherwise, the signals are just crossing in the dark. So I like to use the analogy of dancers, you know, and you're shifting partners. When you shift a partner, you have to change your step a little bit to come into step with your new partner. It's that way in our brain. The brain cells have to speed up or slow down and then form a temporary coherence or move into synchrony, a temporary synchrony while they're sharing information, and then they move out of synchrony when they're done. It's very fluid. These functional connections are changing on a millisecond by millisecond basis, and we can exercise that ability to speed up and slow down, the brain cell's ability, and that's what the brain time is all about. It exercises, it presents a challenging sequence to the brain to follow, time sequence, kind of syncopated, and then the brain does that, and it's like exercise for the brain, a very fundamental basic skill that facilitates all the different brain parts talking with each other smoothly.
We're talking with Dr. James Otis. He is a functional neurologist, a chiropractor who has expanded his whole world into the area of neurochiropractic. If you want to join us and ask some of these questions I'm trying to ask, 510-834-4897 or 1-800-958-9008, 848-4425 or 1-800-958-9008. So if you want to join us, those are the numbers. and give us a call. Now, okay, so how do you do that? I mean, how do you get there? We're doing this thing in a millisecond, and I got a brain over here closing and opening. How do you get them all in the same orchestra?
Okay, so what we do is we have people listen through headphones. We found that was the easiest way to do it.
Okay.
So people listen through headphones, and they'll hear some timed sequences in one side in one ear and a different set of timed sequences in the other. And it might sound something like beep, 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 but they're all, and forgive my rendition here, but there's a lot of different speeds of that, faster and slower. But it's a syncopated presentation, and sometimes it goes faster, beep, beep, beep. And the brain tries to follow that. The brain tries to predict when that next sound is, so it'll speed up or slow down in order to hear the sound. And that's just something our brain does. While we're looking at each other, Michael, and you see my lips moving, you see that with the occipital lobe of your brain. The temporal lobe of your brain shifts its rhythms so that it's on when you anticipate, your brain anticipates the sound of my voice, my lips reaching your ears. So our brain does that all the time.
Actually, I was thinking about lunch, but no. But,
oh, okay, yeah. No, well, it's shifting for that.
No, but go ahead.
Yeah, yeah.
No, but I mean, I understand. How do you, with so many different variables, how do you determine what these sounds should be?
That has been a process that it's been a 20-year development process.
Mm-hmm.
And we patented it, and that's yes, it's been a long process of working with, again, first brain injury people and just finding out what works. And then when it worked with them, it would generalize.
Mm-hmm.
So generally over the years, I've been very blessed to work with people with brain injuries,
mm-hmm,
because their brains are delicate. And if you do the right thing, it'll help, just like my wife back, whatever that was, almost 30 years ago. And if you do the wrong thing, they fatigue really fast. And you can tell really fast, hey, this is not helpful. So that working with that population and finding out what worked there and helping them, that's how we developed it.
All right. Now, when you apply these things to people, I mean, obviously you have to have a very sophisticated intake process to understand, mm-hmm, what the problems really are.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because if these are unique sounds that change the whole dynamic for an individual, you really have to have a pretty good sense of what's going on with that individual.
Great question. Okay, so here, and that leads to, I would actually like to distinguish between my hat as a clinician in private practice in Oakland, California, and my development of brain time, which is the sound system that we have been talking about. The sound system is a general system that's helpful for everybody. It's safe and effective for many different conditions. So it is not, I don't need to do it. It's not a doctor-patient relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Many other doctors around the country are using it and recommending it, but a lot of people can just get it on the website. And there is a website, mm-hmm, braintime.com.
Mm-hmm.
Just spell like it sounds, braintime.com. And people can get that without going through their doctor. And that's one of the things that I wanted, was to be able to give people who couldn't afford to come see me, you know, whatever it was, fly across the country or spend the money, you know, to come see me, that they could have a really inexpensive, direct way of accessing that on their own.
And one of the easiest ways, let me give the numbers, 848-4425 in the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008 is our toll-free number. Tell us some stories about how this works and some situations in which you've used it successfully.
Okay.
Let's get through some cases here about, and because I noticed that when I look at your topics for the discussions you have with your community, a lot of them have to do with just the overall sense of what your life should look like as opposed to what a specific disease is like.
Yes.
So tell us some stories about some of the successes that you've had utilizing these techniques.
So I'll tell stories based on brain time.
Okay.
And again, distinguished from my practice. And the difference is, in my practice, we go into more depth and we individualize it,
right,
and we add additional,
right,
things. So with that brain time technology, we see a range of results. We see some true miracles, and then we see more, and by miracles I mean fast, dramatic results,
mm-hmm,
and I'll tell you some stories. And then we also see just more slow, steady growth and improvement. So a couple of miracles. One of them is a person named Dennis had a stroke back in 1999 and couldn't open his left hand to take communion at church. So, and he was very aware of this. And so, in essence, he couldn't supinate his hand and open at the same time. And
which means he couldn't give communion. He couldn't give.
He couldn't take
give
off.
Couldn't give offering either. But go
That's
ahead.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
But go ahead.
And so then he listened to Brain Time for 2 days, and 2 days later he noticed he could open his hand in that position. And this was after 14 and a half years. Okay. And again, this is in the fast acting category, and I'll tell you some more stories about people who responded more slowly. Another fast-acting story is a child with Asperger's. His mom brought him in, and he had had a difficult time falling asleep. It took him 2 hours to fall asleep every night for the last 3 years. And within three five-minute episodes of listening to Brain Time, and we recommend 5 minutes twice a day, he was falling asleep within 5 minutes, and it was a life changer for his mom. And so that's another like a miracle story, you know, kind of thing. Another older woman came in, and she had not been able to balance very well. And so when one of the tests, this was something I did in office. These other two people were online kind of things. In office, when we did a test where we had her put her feet together and close her eyes, she couldn't stand up. She was just wobbly, wobbly, wobbly. And then we had her listen to the Brain Time for 5 minutes, and she could stand quite steadily. And so, again, these are fast examples. Now, other times we see people who have had a plateau in their recovery from a brain injury, and they've gotten a good results for working with physical therapy and occupational therapy and speech therapy, but then they plateau out. And then they start listening to Brain Time, and they start breaking through that plateau and making more improvement. And it's a similar kind of thing with the learning disabilities and the ADHD. Generally, we suggest that people listen for 5 minutes twice a day for a period of a month, and then evaluate how you're doing. Do some kind of before and after assessment, and then see how you're doing at the end of a month.
You know, tell us how you look differently at something like ADHD. I mean, in order for this to work, you have to have a different approach to it. I mean, it couldn't all just be non-synchronous, brain not listening to each other. You must look at it somewhat differently than the average person.
Yeah. There's a couple of pieces, things that are happening with ADHD. One is there's a differential in the activity in the two sides of the brain. The two sides of a human brain have very different functions, and they're more different in humans than they are in other animals. And in a simple way, the right side of our brain gets the big picture, and it also serves as an inhibitory control for a lot of impulsive behavior. The left side of our brain really loves details. So the left side of our brain will do the verbal language, the math computation. The right side of the brain will do the math comprehension and the body language and the social skills. So for many kids, one side of the brain develops faster than the other. So it's as if for a child with ADHD, the left side of the brain is 11 years old and the right side of their brain is 7 years old. So they have the emotional or inhibitory control of a 7-year-old, and they're excelling with some of their school subjects that require a more analytical approach. And this is especially true with something like Asperger's and low-functioning autism and high-functioning autism and that kind of thing. So there's a differential maturation process. So now there's two ways to approach that. That developed originally on the basis of poor functional connectivity. If the two sides, they have to talk with each other. We always, it's like a car. You need an accelerator and a brake, an accelerator and a brake. And if one side, if they're not talking with each other, one side comes to dominate. So for an ADHD child, the left side comes to dominate and the right side is just left behind. And so therapeutically, one way to go about helping this child is to reestablish good communication right and left, which the Brain Time is very helpful at that. And the second one is to give preferential activation, sensory activation, to the right side of the brain. And that could be as varied as moving your eyes in particular planes of motion that demand activity on the right side of your brain more than the left. It might be doing things like turning vestibular stimulation or turning to the left which activates the right side of the brain more than turning to the right, which activates the left side of the brain. So we would use some type of combination of getting the communication better so the two sides can equalize out on their own, and then secondly, coming back in and giving preferential stimulation to the side that's slow. In the case of ADHD, that would be the right side.
So then how do you do that?
For example, a really typical scenario is someone in my practice, now we're talking my practice, comes in and first thing we'll do is we'll get them started on the brain time and make sure they're using it and we can get that habit established. And that helps a lot right in of itself. Then we start adding in other kinds of exercise. I will give them what are called small amplitude saccade eye exercises. And they spend 2 minutes just looking at following a target with their eyes. And I will give them, for example, spinning exercises. And that's spinning to the left kinds of exercises. And we'll have the mom start to do slow, deep massage on the child, especially their legs. And there's, for the geeks in the audience, that slow, deep massage preferentially activates a particular kind of nerve, these slow velocity nerve fibers that are preferentially strong in the right side of the brain. They develop in utero. They're very primitive, and they can that kind of massage is very helpful for the right side of the brain. So then they go home and they do that generally 10, 15 minutes a day. And then come back in a week, and then we'll reassess the neurological findings. How well can that child move his or her eyes? Can they stay on target if I ask them to shift their gaze from one target to another? Can they maintain their balance as well as they on their right leg as well as they could on the left? And we'll just track their progress, and it'll show up, and then we'll adjust the exercises accordingly. They go home, do those exercises for 10 to 15 minutes. So we're very much relying on that child and his or her parents to provide the oomph behind it. And so we're not so much, yeah, sometimes we do nutritional supplements and sometimes very often stimulant medication is helpful. It can be very helpful. But we're taking a different tact here. We're building the substrate that supports sustained attention, where a child can inhibit the distractions.
So the assumption is that these are actually developed based upon a few assumptions about how the brain works. Do people challenge notions like that? I mean, here again, every time I've talked to someone, they have a different theory mm-hmm. about why. Is there actually proof that all this works?
Yeah, there's a couple of different really hot fields now in neuroscience research, They focus on this field of plasticity, in essence, the brain's ability to change, to grow and change. And one of the very big areas of research is a field called synaptic timing-dependent plasticity. It's a long technical word, but what it means is that when two brain cells are trying to build a connection with each other, which is what we have to do if we want to mature the right side of the brain or the left side of the brain. We want to build a pathway. We have to build new connections between brain cells. That's what learning is all about, and that's what maturation is all about, or learning any new skill is all about. You have to build new connections. So when two brain cells want to build a connection between each other, a physical connection we're talking now, they have to, again, time their on-off rhythms so they're on at the right time and off at the right time. And if they fire asynchronously, that will actually weaken a pre-existing condition. And if they fire at the right time, that will strengthen help build a connection or strengthen it. And so our brain is constantly remodeling itself. In fact, 70%, it's kind of mind-blowing in a way, how much our brain is constantly remodeling itself. 70% of all of the connections between one nerve and another, called synapses, are modified every day. That is huge. It is absolutely huge. And we could talk a lot about that, what sleep plays in that role and all that stuff, but timing is crucial. So the ability of the brain to do this, speeding up, slowing down, adjusting its rhythms, helps regulate the kind of plasticity and growth. Now, another really, and you can Google and, you know, do a PubMed search, and there are thousands and thousands and thousands of articles about that. And then another really big area is something called functional connectivity. And so, again, we look there at how much functional, how much communication is happening between two brain areas on a second-by-second basis. And it's really clear that in all of these functional problems, like ADHD, learning disabilities, autism, memory stuff, there is a breakdown of communication. There's abnormal communication patterns going on in the brain. We're not talking about damage to the axons or the physical connections, just how those are activated, how they are being used functionally.
Can you do this other, I mean, are there other ways to make, to get, to bring about this cerebral peace between the cells beside brain time? Are there supplements? Are there other ways of doing it beside? Oh.
You betcha. Okay. So here, and that brings up another, we can talk about it, Michael, in terms of plasticity again.
So, plasticity meaning to our audience what?
Okay, what that means is how our brain changes.
Okay.
So if we want to create, if we want to change our lives, really good place to start with is our brain. If we want to change our emotional state, long-term emotional state, really good places to change our brain. And so our brains have a bias for using some kinds of pathways. And some make us happy, some make us not happy, some make us feel anxious, some make us feel stressed. And we can grow those pathways. It's like a habit in our brain. And so there's this maxim of what you pay attention to grows in your life and in your brain. So every time we focus on something, we literally change our brain. And so we have a tremendous ability to change our brain by our conscious volitional, what we do day in and day out. And one, and that includes things like physical exercise. Physical exercise is one, I'm going to stop it. We can cover like three or four major areas of ways that lifestyle changes to make your brain healthy.
Let's keep doing it.
And okay, so one of them is exercise. And when we exercise, there's nothing better for the development of our brain than the protection of our brain and the restoration of function. So people who exercise in middle age and as seniors, as elders, they are protected from the onset of Alzheimer's and other cognitive issues. They much lower incidence. It really cuts the incidence. People who exercise can sustain more damage to the brain before they start to show symptoms, they're more resilient. Exercise is one of the best things for helping a child. Get them out and run them. Get them exhausted. And it will help a lot of cognitive and behavioral kinds of things because it helps grow the brain. So our brains require stimulation to grow. And there's a huge amount of stimulation that comes from our physical movement, the coordination of running and balancing and all of that kind of thing. Our brains require good blood flow and blood delivery, and that's all based on the autonomic nervous system. And exercise is great for keeping your blood flow mechanisms in good shape. And blood flow to your brain equals good health. You can't have good brain health without good blood flow. So exercise is one very important thing. Now, another thing that you can do is with the base of our brain, this automatic part of our brain, this non-thinking, that we can stimulate or exercise, preferentially activate the calming part of the base of our brain. It's called the parasympathetic nervous system, or like the rest and digest, as opposed to the fight or flight part of our nervous system. Slow, deep breathing is just one simple, tried and true way of calming down. So you often hear people say, hey, take a deep breath if you're feeling stressed. And when you take a conscious, slow, deep breath, you're activating the parasympathetic part of your nervous system, and that helps take you out of the fight or flight. Fight or flight makes it hard to think clear. So that's one.
Before we go on, let me give the numbers again. 848-4425 and 1-800-958-9008. I know there are a lot of these things we're talking about. We want you to get engaged in the conversation. There are some of the questions that that I'm thinking about, I think you're thinking about as well, and some of the notions that... let's challenge Dr. Otis a little bit on some of these things, because this is not tried and true. This is a little bit new. This is a little bit different from the way a lot of people think about it. So I'm counting on you to talk, to help me talk to Dr. Otis about these issues. 848-4425, 1-800-958-9008. Let's go to Miriam in San Francisco. You're on About Health.
Oh, good afternoon. I just wanted to say that your guest is absolutely correct. I have been involved in a number of automobile accidents and injury to my lower back, specifically to the coccyx and also to the cervix, particularly the third and the fourth one. And I have been a practitioner of a form of chi for over 45 years. It has accelerated the process of healing. In addition, I have been a practitioner of a very healthy diet for over 40 years. I eat only organically grown food, and I do not eat red meat or eat sugar, rich white sugar. And so as a result, I'm quite physically well for my age. I'm 83. And as a result, I'm at the point where now I can begin a new phase of awareness in terms of the quality of life, because my family's all grown and out of the house. And now I can proceed to the next level of development internally as well as cognitively. So I'm saying that what your guest has pursued or is undertaking is absolutely correct. And I would encourage more people to consider health as the primary focus of their life for enrichment and long life.
Sounds, do you want to comment on that, Doctor?
Just Miriam, you're doing great. You're an inspiration.
All right, let's go to Richmond and talk to Irene. You're on About Health. Irene?
Hi, Doctor.
Or is this Cindy? Here I am, got a loss of this again. Is this Cindy or Irene?
Hi, Doctor. Thank you for your show.
All right. Go ahead.
Yeah, so I had been reading that book, The Brain That Changes Itself, and I was particularly fascinated by a chapter they were talking about, you know, post-war vets who have had amputations and, like, the thing called, I can't remember, it's like when your limb is still, phantom limbs.
Mm-hmm.
And my question is about how can your program or any of the models that you've tried deal with the chronic pain? And can you explain why anything like your, what is it, mind games? Or what did you call that thing, brain time? How would that affect a person who's trying to overcome some chronic pain issues?
Great question. I'm sorry, is it Irene?
Yes.
Great. So let's talk just a little bit about what happens with chronic pain in your brain. Pain is not a bad thing in and of itself. We have to have pain. But when it gets chronic and it's too active, then of course it causes really big problems. So our brain has inherent mechanisms to regulate pain. And you've read about some of that in Michael Merzenich's book, or The Brain That Changes Itself. And what will happen is, for example, when a soldier walks, can have their leg blown off in a battle and walk off the battlefield and not feel pain because their brain has suppressed the pain. But then once they're out of harm's way, then they feel the pain. And then you can have the situation that you described, where somebody, they amputate and they feel excruciating pain as if they still had that leg.
Mm-hmm.
So all of that is a brain-based phenomenon. It's not the leg, okay? And so there are inhibitory, we've been talking about accelerators and brakes. We need to be able to both turn up and turn down pain. And so what's happened in the case of chronic pain, there's a threefold thing. One is the pathways that would be inhibiting the pain aren't doing their job, or they're not as strong as we'd like them to be. Another piece is that the brain actually contributes to inflammation through a process called neurogenic inflammation. And that means the brain cells themselves or the nerve cells themselves in the peripheral tissue release inflammatory chemicals. So that can contribute to pain in and of itself. And so the basic thing to do with chronic pain is we want to start regulating the brain. That's where we start. And the brain time in and of itself has been helpful for a number of people. I especially notice that with folks with fibromyalgia. I've had four or five people come back and say, wow, my fibromyalgia is better. And then there are other things that are possible to do in office that would require more of an examination.
Okay, thank you for that question. Let's go to Fresno and talk to Cindy. You're on About Health.
I have a question, and it has to do with some changes that I've noticed as I get a little older, and I was wondering if sometimes your slowness can be attributed to a lack of estrogen. And the problem is I have no problems reading or comprehending, writing, nothing like that, as long as it's a solo activity. But sometimes when I'm conversing with people and I have to think quickly and process what they're saying and then respond, I'm clearly not as quick as I used to be.
Yes, absolutely. Estrogen can be playing an important factor here. And the reason is that there are a lot of estrogen receptors in your brain. So that's how hormones change your mood. So, and you know, a lot of people know that, hey, at different parts of my cycle, I have different emotional tones. Your brain is working differently depending on the hormonal balance in your body. And so absolutely low estrogen can cause issues. And so whatever you do to address that is very helpful. And there's – okay, I'll stop there.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the good question.
848-4425 is our local number in the 510 area code. 1-800-958-9008 is our toll-free number. Let me give you some information before we get too far along and I miss the opportunity. The website for Dr. Otis is gemotisdc.com. Or braintime.com, and we'll mention this several times before we finish. Let's go to Sam Rafael and talk to Joan. You're on About Health. Joan?
Yes. Hi, Dr. Lenore.
Hi.
I had a question regarding PTSD, and, you know, just as for soldiers, they can sometimes get triggered with something that reminds them of a past experience, and their whole body goes into that fight or flight response. I was wondering, is there a way, you know, in that moment, aside from deep breathing and just knowing that, you know, in your mind, logically, that reality is safe in that moment, is there a way to decompress or retrain the brain to actually clear that trauma at a root level so that, you know, those things, that trigger doesn't happen on such a deep core level?
Mm-hmm. Yes, there are. And think of it, Joan, as you have to address multiple different areas of the brain and come at it from many different approaches. The more different ways you approach it, the better your results are going to be. So one of them, when there's a PTSD phenomenon going on, the brain is overly active looking for danger. Now, we all have that. We inherit that. It's just built into our genes that we have what we call a negativity bias, and that served our ancestors who were living on the savannah very well. So if something moves in the bushes, we turn and look at it to make sure it's safe, and then we activate our sympathetic nervous system to run for fight or flight.
Mm-hmm.
And so just as humans, we're born with a built-in negativity bias. So, for example, if we experiments show that we perceive angry faces faster than happy faces, and and it just goes over and over and over. We go through our day, and 20 things go well, and one thing goes wrong, and then we're falling asleep at night, and the one thing that runs through our head for almost all of us is that one thing that went wrong. That's it's so common. I see Dr. Lenore smiling as well. So, So there is, that's a genetic bias, a built-in bias, and overactivity, especially on the right side of the brain, whose assignment is to get the big picture, assess whether I'm safe, and give a preferential nod to I'd better be careful. So you can retrain that. And for example, one way to retrain that right side of your brain is to make a conscious exercise every day of noticing what's going well in your life. And remember how we talked about what you pay attention to grows in your brain?
Yeah.
So just pay attention to what's going well and actually let it soak in. Make it like you're brushing your teeth, even if it feels corny. Just write it down even. Just notice what's going well. Okay, now, another thing you can do, we need to get the left side of your brain in on the picture here as well. Because the left side of the brain does that kind of evaluation that you mentioned where... Yeah. I really am safe, you know, like that kind of cognitive appraisal of things. And yes, it's really important to get that side of your brain involved. And when the left side of your brain is on automatic, it kind of goes into this automatic negative style of thinking. It's almost like a non-conscious kind of thinking that we catch ourselves thinking like after the fact. And so, oh, you know, nobody likes me, or wow, that person's, you know, this will never work, or, you know, whatever it is, it's not really cognitively based. And so one good exercise for that is a really tried and proven exercise of simply writing out, using writing by hand or whatever to activate the left side of your brain, and to write three things that are going well each day, and then write at least three reasons why they're going well. And so the left side of your brain likes to explain things. It can go into confabulation if you don't. That's another story. But it likes to explain things. So make it explain why things are going well. And so I got a raise at work. Well, why did that happen? Well, my boss likes me. I worked hard. God wants me to have money for my daughter's education. There's no right or wrong. Just make up answers. Just put them there. And then that's going to exercise the left side of your brain. Do the deep breathing exercises. That's a great way to do it. And then also on Brain Time, we have what we call Brain Time resilience exercises, which are specific for the brain stem, the base of the brain, to help build that ability to shift back and forth between sympathetic and parasympathetic. And somebody in PTSD is stuck in sympathetic. We need to be able to shift back and forth.
Yeah, I think when looking at my history, there's definitely triggers. And I had a brain injury about 10 years ago, and it was the frontal lobe, parietal, and the occiput. All of them were affected, and I became a lot more high-strung, intense, and reactive, and fearful. And so it's been 10 years of recuperation. I've gotten so much better, but there's some things that just send me into that state, that fight or flight. It's crazy what the body physiologically goes through.
That's right.
So thank you so much.
Thank you. And I think what you're saying, you see in all of the various and sundry magazines like Science and Discover, it used to be thought that the brain couldn't change. And once you got a brain to a certain place, there was very little that you could do to change kind of. What we're finding out is that brain cells are very resilient.
Yeah.
Can even regrow at times. 848-44-25, 510 area code, 1-800-9-589-008. It's now time to go to talk to Alan Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Hi.
Hi.
I have a friend in his mid-60s who started having epileptic seizures about 5 years ago. And about 6 months ago, he had a really bad one that erased a huge amount of memory.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's on a drug now, which seems to be controlling the seizures. And he's gotten most of a lot of that memory back. But his short-term memory is just almost non-functional.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything that can be done?
You know, I don't know, Alan, but I would certainly give these things a try that we're talking about, especially the brain time. It's so, like, easy to use and inexpensive, and just give it a go and see if it helps. I don't know, but I have seen cases like that where it has helped. So that's my thought. So, I don't know.
But. So explain to us the process so that, like, Al and I can understand. When we go to the BrainTime website, how do we decide what we're going to do for it? I've never been there, so explain how you actually use it.
Okay. So the way that you use it is it's a subscription.
Right.
So you sign up. You put your credit card information in there. It's a $27 a month subscription.
Right.
It's no obligation. You stop, you know, anytime. And then you get a username and your password and a password. You log in.
All right.
And then there is play bars, some explanations and some learning modules, kind of like what we've been talking about today. But then the actual training is a little play bar, and you press the play bar, you put on the headphones, and you make sure that your hearing sounds correctly. We'll give you a test that says you should hear your sound in the right ear, and now you should hear it in your left ear. You make sure your headphones are lined up correctly, and then you press play. You sit and close your eyes and listen for 5 minutes, and you're done. And then you do that again at the end of the day. And it's fine to do more, but that's the basics. And all these stories that I told you about earlier in this program were based on that 5 minutes twice a day kind of model.
And so if I'm anxious, and I'm a member,
mm-hmm.
Is there a spot there for anxiety? Is there a spot there for stress? Or is it all just one set of...
There are some exercises. There are a number of exercises on the page in our training area, in our member area. And one of them is especially good for anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
And it's this one called resilience, which helps us deal with stress effectively, to meet challenges so that we're not thrown off center. And that's exercising this very base part of our brain. And then there are other areas in that training that help us reorganize our brain, the right side of our brain, so that it functions to remind us that life is good rather than life is dangerous. And it helps us hold our attention steady in a way that's helpful for us. And then there's another exercise on the website that strengthens the left side of our brain and gives us that ability to choose a goal and move toward a goal. And again, good brain function means all the parts of our brain have to work well together. And happiness is about, yes, it's being satisfied with, you know, our life, our current life as it is, but it's also striving for our goals and knowing that we can make progress in our goals. It's not just I'm happy with the world as it is. That's an important component, and it's not just striving for goals. It's both.
It's about a sense of accomplishment.
That's right.
All right, let's go now to Ron in Concord. You're on About Health.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me?
We can.
Fantastic. I want to thank you so much for your show. You're one of the reasons I re-up every year with KPFA.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Tell the management that.
I thank you because there are not many health shows out there on your standard television station, these health shows. This type of information is so important. Your guests are so informative, and it's the cutting edge. Enough with that said, is this show archived? Can I go? There's so much information.
Yes, it's archived.
Oh, that's fantastic. And I just wanted to ask a question of your guests. I didn't catch his name. I came in.
No, please go ahead.
And that's about with people who approach post-traumatic stress disorder with sexual assault, rape, there's rapid eye movement desensitization. I'm not sure of the actual term,
mm-hmm.
but it sounds like it's something that you would do in your field. I'll take my answer offline. Okay?
Okay. Great, Ron. So thank you. And for those of you who came in late, I'm Dr. Jim Otis, and there's a website that we've been talking about, BrainTime. Go to BrainTime.com. And then I do have a private practice as well, and that is JimOtisDC.com in Oakland. And so, Ron, with the EMDR, I don't use that particular technique, but it is great. And what they're doing there is you're going to be moving your eyes back and forth and sequentially activating. By moving your eyes back and forth, you sequentially activate the two sides of your brain. So it helps break up stagnant patterns. It enhances the functional connectivity, which we talked about earlier in the show, between the two sides of your brain. And when the two sides of your brain are talking together and cooperating together, life goes better.
Okay, sounds good. All right, let's go to Berkeley and talk to Saad. Thank you, Saad, for being so patient.
No problem. Thanks, guys. Quick question. So I'm a medical student, and I end up using binaural sort of the sound techniques where there's a frequency difference between the two ears.
Mm-hmm.
I used that to study. I ended up cutting out my study time down to like 25%. Like instead of 8 hours a day, I was studying 2 hours a day.
Mm-hmm.
And inadvertently, I ended up using some of that eye movement stuff mm-hmm. just to kind of like help my eyes feel like not so just staring straight at the screen. Both those things seem to help me quite a bit. So I want to know, what's the difference between the sort of the binaural audio technique, mm-hmm. brain time? And just one more additional question. What does the doc think about substance P inhibitors and chronic pain therapy?
So, Asad, that's a lot of really great questions. The binaural beat technology is, as you mentioned, and for people who don't know, you listen through headphones, and you listen usually for an hour at a time, 30 minutes to an hour at a time, something in that range. And the difference in the beats entrains your brain. And that's just a technical word, but the brain starts to follow along with those beats. And aside, I'll talk a little bit technical here with you. The brain time is more an evoked potential. It works on those regards.
Oh.
Okay. And so it's stimulating on a very intermittent basis a process that your brain is trying. It's an exercise for your brain. The entrainment technologies, the binaural beat technologies, and a number of companies out there offering that are more, they're imposing a rhythm on the brain. So, and practically, I find that the brain time gets faster, more efficacious results.
Okay.
Great.
That makes sense. That actually does make sense, because it does feel like it is forcing me to focus when it's a little bit unnatural.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Watson, Doc, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
You're really welcome.
All right.
And good luck with your studies.
Let's go to Watsonville, talk to Judith. You're on About Health.
Hi. Thank you for taking my call. I'm calling. I struggle with chemical sensitivities, which can cause a variety of different anxiety related to different situations where I am exposed to chemicals. I don't know whether you have any awareness of, what if there's any brain connection with the whole chemical sensitivity dynamic, or any suggestions for someone like me.
Yes, I do. And I'm going to give you a website to get a referral. So that would be one. You're in Watsonville. And so just in general, when you have the chemical sensitivity, it's an immunological phenomenon. So your brain, your immune system is reacting to chemicals that it wouldn't under healthier conditions. Okay, so it's like the immune system is trigger happy, and to rehabilitate that, number one, you have a challenging condition, but there absolutely can be things that can help. You'll want to find somebody that can help give you guidance for balancing your immune system, and that always includes balancing your digestive system, because 70% of your immune system lines your digestive tract. It always involves addressing your brain, because, for example, lesions on one side of your brain would cause a preponderance of innate immunity versus acquired immunity, which, and those two have to be able to swing back and forth. Your brain controls inflammatory processes to a very large degree. It sends signals about when to start inflammation, when to stop inflammation. So the brain will be an important component, but it's certainly not the whole thing. And here's a website that you might get some people with. And I would, when you call them, ask what their experience here with this. It's called acnb.org. ACNB. And that stands for American Chiropractic Neurology Board. And a lot of those people have good training in a field called functional medicine as well, which we can do some of this, helping you with your digestive and immune system and that kind of stuff. So, give those a try.
Okay. Thank you so much.
All right. Let's talk a little bit about sleep.
Okay.
Let's talk a little bit about sleep.
Okay. Sleep. I like to, really step
back. Let's talk a little bit about insomnia.
Okay. That's a good one. Sleep is one of the most important parts of our lifestyle. And especially, as it pertains to the brain, which is the primary function of sleep is actually to protect our brain. So scientists have wondered for years, why do we sleep? Why do animals sleep? You mean, after all, they're not being productive. They're more prone to predators. They're, you know, like, so why sleep? And we know it's really important for our health, and we've known that. If you get sleep deprived, your immune system goes down, your ability to think goes down, your mood goes down. It affects all kinds of diseases. It has a big effect on cardiovascular disease, increased risk of cardiovascular disease. So we've known it had a some negative effects, but we didn't really understand why. And now we're starting to be able to elucidate why sleep has such an importance for our health and especially our brain. When we're asleep, our brain cleans itself. So the lymphatic drainage around our brain doubles when we're at sleep. So that's when our brain is cleaning itself and getting rid of the proteins that cause Alzheimer's, and they're getting rid of the things that contribute to degenerative disease. That's also the time when our brain reorganizes itself after our really busy day. It's kind of like you clean off your desk, you file things in the file cabinet. So our brain is filing things away. And it's important for our memory retention. If you learn facts and you don't sleep, you can't remember them the next day. So don't cram for your test. It's counterproductive. So you'll actually do better with your memory if you have a chance to sleep after you learn something. So sleep is hugely, hugely, hugely important. And we know that sleep affects our brain. We've just been talking about that. But we also know that our brain affects our sleep. So people who've had a brain injury or a stroke or, you know, some kind of problem with their brain, their sleep starts to deteriorate. And so it's one of, like, the best predictor, or one very strong predictor of Alzheimer's and degenerative disease is how well you're sleeping. Sleep affects, helps the brain helps sleep, and we need to address it from both sides, okay? And so you can address it by both sides with one good sleep hygiene. So that is good sleep hygiene means getting to bed on time, keeping your room quiet, keeping it dark, keeping it cool. There's a number of different things. And we actually have a website called sleepwellhealwell.com, which explains a lot of this stuff. sleepwellhealwell.com. And so you want to make sure your environment is good, your sleep hygiene is good, and then you also want to address your brain. And that's where some of these exercises that we've already talked about can be really, really helpful, because is the biggest thing that keeps us awake at night is unresolved stress in our sympathetic nervous system stuck in overdrive. We're stuck in that fight or flight, and we're not going into the rest and digest part.
Is that where you make notes for the right side and for the left side?
Yes, those are one good way to do that.
All right. Well, you know, the time always goes by pretty quickly. Can you believe it's been almost an hour? I'm going to give you these websites. So the braintime.com is where you kind of get some information. You can tell you how to join, how to get there. And then once you get there, obviously it's pretty self-explanatory how to use it. And still jimbotisdc.com, still there. But certainly you've taken a whole different path. I think our audience found it useful, and I found it extremely interesting. And I remember when we first started having these conversations, there was not nearly as much being written about how the brain changes and how you can change your brain. But every single journal I'd pick up on from the airport, you know, Discover, Scientific American, they're all talking about the same thing. So I guess you were ahead of the game.
I guess so. It's so exciting, Michael. Mm-hmm. The possibilities are just opening up day by day.
All right. Well, Dr. James Otis, D.C., braintime.com or jimotisdc.com. Thank you for joining us. And certainly thank you for listening and for the good calls that we had. Remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike, and we'll talk again next week.
filmmakers. Your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to make a short film, 5 minutes or less, within 48 hours. You're invited to assemble your team and rendezvous at Berkeley Community Media's studio on Friday, July 25th at 5 p.m. There, during the launch party, you'll be given three ingredients to incorporate into your film. You'll have 48 hours to write, shoot, edit, and return with your film by Sunday, July 27th at 6 p.m. To recap, that's the fourth annual BCM 48-Hour Filmmaker Challenge. Friday, July 25th to Sunday, July 27th at Berkeley Community Media, 2239 Martin Luther King Jr. Way in Berkeley. This is a benefit for Berkeley Community Media. For more information, call 510-848-2288 or go to www.betv.org. RSVP today at the BCM Facebook page.